हरि ओम। लेट्स टॉक अबाउट प्राणायाम। इट इज अ सेकेंड स्टेप इन हठ योग एंड फोर्थ स्टेप इन अष्टांग योग प्रैक्टिस। बट इन हठ योग एंड अष्टांग योग दिस प्राणायाम प्रैक्टिस कम्स आफ्टर आसनस। इट मीन्स दैट इट इज मच मोर स्ट्रांग देन आसना प्रैक्टिस as far as the effects are concerned, and also you need to have certain level of asana practice to be able to do pranayama. So let's see what is this. It's often called as yoga breathing. The word pranayama is actually made up of two words, prana and ayam. Prana means the life force, the vital energy, and ayam means control. So the word pranayam is all about control of this vital energy that is responsible for the function of our body and mind both. And that is why pranayam is a process of controlling the mind. It is a process to control the thinking process, the different thoughts, the different emotions. In Hatha Yoga Pradipika, a verse says, Chale vate chale chittam nischalam nischalo bhavet. As long as the prana is not controlled, is uncontrolled, the mind will be disturbed and will not be under our control. Like we don't have control over our thoughts and emotions. We can control them for a few seconds, but after that it is very difficult. Why? Because the pranic energy is not controlled. So if you control the pranic energy, you can control the thoughts, you can control the emotions. Then pranayama is also connected with positive health. In Hatha Yoga Pradipika again, it said, प्राणायामेन युक्तेन सर्वरोग क्षयो भवेत। एवरी डिजीज कैन बी डिस्ट्रॉयड विद द प्रैक्टिस ऑफ प्राणायाम। एंड लॉजिकली वी कैन कनेक्ट इट विद द डेफिनेशन। द लाइफ फोर्स, द एनर्जी, द वाइटल एनर्जी, इफ दैट इज कंट्रोल्ड देन हेल्थ कैन बी रिस्टोर्ड। प्राणायाम इन योगा ट्रेडिशंस इज कनेक्टेड विद लॉन्जिविटी। Proper practice of pranayama and you can increase your lifespan. Now these three important things that I mentioned, pranayama is to control the mind, pranayama is to destroy all the diseases in our body, and pranayama is to increase our life. I'm going to explain in the next few slides as to how we can achieve this. Pranayama is a process of breathing. So definitely pranayama has a strong connection with the respiratory system, lungs, the diaphragm, the nervous system that controls this diaphragm and lungs. In the practice of pranayama, there's a lot of different types of breathing that is involved. There is very slow and deep breathing involved. There is very fast breathing also involved. Then there is holding of breath that is also involved. Overall, if you see, the pranayama is about improving the efficiency of respiratory system. And there are studies that I'm going to discuss which have indicated that regular practice of pranayama does improve the efficiency of respiratory system. It does improve the lung capacity. And studies have also showed that greater lung capacity is one of the predictors of longevity. Long life and lung capacity, they go hand in hand. Pranayama is also about rhythm to the breath. दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट वर्ड. देर इज अ डिसिप्लिन टू द ब्रेथ एंड दैट इज प्राणायाम. इफ यू सी वेन द ब्रेथ डज नॉट हैव डिसिप्लिन, इफ इट इज समटाइम्स फास्ट, चेक द माइंड, वी मस्ट बी एंशियस और वी मस्ट बी स्ट्रेस्ड. इफ द ब्रेथ इज वेरी शैलो, प्रोबेबली अगेन कनेक्टेड विथ स्ट्रेस. इफ यू आर एंग्री, इट्स अ वेरी फोर्सफुल बट वेरी फास्ट ब्रीदिंग. देन हेल्थ वाइज ऑल्सो, इफ यू हैव एस्थमा, देर इज अ डिफरेंट ब्रीदिंग पैटर्न. देर इज अ लिटिल हंच इन द अपर बैक एंड द ब्रीदिंग इज वेरी शैलो अगेन. मेनी डिफरेंट हेल्थ रिलेटेड प्रॉब्लम्स एंड द ब्रीदिंग रिदम इज affected, it changed. So pranayam goes opposite. Pranayam says restore this rhythm, and that is a way to achieve a positive health. In your body, every organ has rhythm. Your brain has rhythm. The brain sleeps at certain time, wakes up at certain time. There's hormones in our body, they are released at certain time. Cortisol is released in the early morning around sunrise. In the night, it's very low. So every hormone, every organ, digestive system, we get hungry at proper time. The time doesn't change. Say today I became hungry at say 12 o'clock in the noon, and day after tomorrow I became hungry at 4 o'clock in the morning. It doesn't happen that way, because every organ has a rhythm. So also, mind has a rhythm. And if we want to restore this natural rhythm, the breathing rhythm has to be restored. And that is one of the main objectives of pranayama. If the rhythm is not there, there is some kind of sickness. If the rhythm is restored, the sickness is gone. Now, this pranayama involves three processes. Inhalation is one, it's called purak in Sanskrit. Exhalation is called rechak. And then breath hold is called kumbhak. So let's study these three processes a bit more from physiology perspective. Inhalation, when you inhale, you have to pull the diaphragm down. Then lungs expand. So your diaphragm, when it pushes down on the digestive and the abdominal organs, the abdomen moves out. Same time, the chest is expanding so that the lungs can fill in the air. Now, this is an active process where you need energy for your muscles to expand. And this inhalation also is a stimulation to the sympathetic nervous system. If you just check your heart rate, when you inhale, the heart rate is slightly faster. So it's an active process where you're spending energy. Exhalation is a little bit more passive as compared to inhalation, because you don't have to do a lot of muscular effort. You're just trying to relax the muscles. And it is a trigger to parasympathetic nervous system. And if you check your heart rate, the heart rate decreases slightly. So most of the breathing practices in yoga, you will observe that exhalation is longer than inhalation. Maybe if you practice deep breathing, generally the ratio is 1:2, means if you inhale in 4 counts, you exhale in 8 counts. Now if you do this deep breathing for say 6 minutes, and if the ratio is 1:2, then for 2 minutes you are inhaling and 4 minutes you are exhaling. So 2 minutes your sympathetic nervous system is active, but your parasympathetic nervous system, that is relaxation. Sympathetic is stress, parasympathetic is relaxation in simple words. 4 minutes your parasympathetic nervous system is active. It means that this deep breathing with ratio 1:2 will make you more relaxed. And that is the effect that is seen in many studies, and we can also experience it. Even if you practice it for say 5-6 minutes, you will experience that relaxation. Breath hold is considered more advanced practices. If you really see what happens when you hold the breath hold is included in both ways. After inhalation also you can include the breath hold, which is called antarkumbhak, and you can also hold the breath after exhalation. It's called bahyakumbhak, external retention. This is internal retention and external retention. But in any way, if you retain the breath, the carbon dioxide levels in your blood increase and the oxygen levels actually fall down. They decreased. Now that is something not good. Oxygen levels going down is not good. But look what happens with the increased carbon dioxide levels. When the carbon dioxide is higher, the blood vessels dilate. That's an effect. And there are very small capillaries in the brain, which generally are so thin that the blood may not even circulate there. Now those blood capillaries also dilate. So there is a possibility of increased cerebral circulation in kumbhak. Of course, breath hold is not good. Breath hold is dangerous because oxygen levels are falling. Then there is a very constant stimulation to your respiratory center. And if you still keep holding the breath, then your heart rate will increase. You'll start sweating. So it's not a very pleasant thing to do, kumbhaka or breath hold. It's not also good thing to do. But in pranayam, the yoga masters in the ancient times have used some special bandhas, locks called Jalandhar bandha, the chin lock. And through this chin lock, they have minimized the bad effects of this breath hold while trying to get the nervous system stronger, making the nervous system tolerate low levels of oxygen, high levels of carbon dioxide, and make the brain function. And that's how they could survive when there was no, where there is no oxygen in Himalayas. They can survive. The yoga masters can survive with very low oxygen. This is how they train their nervous system, increase the tolerance and strength of nervous system. Some other techniques of pranayam, which involve fast breathing, like Kapalbhati and Bhastrika, you increase the oxygen levels very high, saturate oxygen level completely, and reduce the carbon dioxide level. Now, in that reduction of carbon dioxide in fast breathing, the blood vessels, the capillaries in the brain, they are going to constrict, reducing the blood flow. So if you do Kapalbhati or Bhastrika again, then you may feel a little dizzy because of this. But then in that case, you are again training your brain to deal with low levels of carbon dioxide. And in the first case, it is very high levels of carbon dioxide. So it is all about strengthening your nervous system. There are some studies that say that pain perception is also reduced with breath hold. Overall, there are certain hormones that are secreted like endorphins, which again reduce the pain perception, reduce the pain. That is again associated with pranayam practice. That also I'm going to discuss again. So these are the three important processes: inhalation, purak, exhalation, rechak, and kumbhak, breath hold, which is involved in pranayam. This is how these processes work. Move ahead. Now, when you breathe in pranayam, what is happening? First, let's understand what is our total lung capacity. It's about 6000 to 7000 cc. That is 6 to 7 liters of air we can inhale and it can fit into our lungs. But the amount of air per breath is not 6000. It's 1/10. That is 600 to 700 cc. So it's very less. So we are not using our lungs to the full capacity. Now in yogic breathing, this is exactly our purpose. That is to increase the air that we inhale per breath. And how to do that? By using more of our diaphragm. Diaphragm, when you inhale, the diaphragm is moved down. And when it moves down, your abdomen expands. This is called vertical breathing because the diaphragm moves down and up. Then the chest breathing is called horizontal breathing, where your chest, the rib cage expands horizontally. And there's a small percentage in your clavicular region, clavicles, upper lungs expand in the neck region. So in yogic breathing, it's recommended that you use more of your diaphragm so you can inhale more. Then you expand your chest to the fullest. That will increase the capacity, the quantity of air, the amount of air. And what that will do? If you inhale more air per breath, it's going to reduce your breath rate. Generally, we inhale about 15 times in a minute. Every time we inhale, the diaphragm moves down, spending energy, taking energy. The chest expands, taking energy. Now, 15 times these muscles are moving in a minute. That is 900 times in 1 hour. And 21,600 times in 24 hours, if you consider 15 as average breathing rate. Now, if per breath I'm going to increase the air, say double of what I'm doing right now, then every minute I will only have to breathe for 7 times. So my muscles are only moving 7 times. So that saves me almost half of my energy. And this is what is the purpose of reducing the breath rate. Now if you see the animals which breathe very low, like very slow breathing animals like turtles, they have lower metabolism and they have long life. So this is one of the main purposes of pranayama practice, to increase the longevity by lowering the metabolism, by lowering the energy consumption per breath. When you use the diaphragm, when you are making the breathing more efficient, like inhaling more, your diaphragm moves more. What it does? It gives a very gentle massage to your all vital organs. That include heart, lung, because the diaphragm, when it moves down, it pushes on the liver, stomach, pancreas, intestines, colon. And when it is, you're exhaling, it is pushed up, again pushing the lungs and heart. Now this gentle massage improves the circulation and the health of these vital organs. Also, this process of deep breathing is connected with endorphin secretions. That brings well-being, state of well-being, and a positive state. And endorphins act as natural painkillers as well. So this is how the deep breathing, the yogic breathing, affects us. Now this deep breathing, the slow breathing, there's so many more benefits of it. Let's go for these benefits. Respiratory system related benefits. This slow breathing increases our lung capacity, the diaphragmatic movement that I already discussed. Then breathing efficiency, that also I discussed. And there are some studies that say that oxygen levels in the blood also increase with this slow and deep breathing. Now the benefits of this slow deep breathing, the yogic breathing basically, means pranayama, are there for cardiovascular and cardiorespiratory system both. Cardiovascular, the blood circulation is increased. Cardiac output, the output of your heart is also increased. The gas exchange efficiency means oxygen absorption and release of carbon dioxide from your alveoli in the lungs is also more efficient. The heart rate variability, which is a direct indication of parasympathetic nervous system, that is relaxation. HRV is relaxation. Increased HRV is indicating your relaxed state. That is also increased because of this slow and deep breathing. And interestingly, the blood pressure also is decreased, which is very good. So high blood pressure is known to cause so many problems. And cardiac work is also reduced. That's also improving the cardiac, the efficiency of our heart. Then if you consider the autonomic nervous system, I already talked about it, that the parasympathetic activity, that is relaxation activity, the vagal tone is improved. And this slow and deep breathing allows us to control the sympathetic, that is stress, in a better way. So in all, this yogic breathing is really helpful and positive for our health. There's one more component of pranayam, which is also a very important component. When I am doing pranayam, I am actually consciously controlling my breath. I am observing my breath. I am becoming aware of my breath. I am mindful of my breath. When I am paying attention to my breath, I am trying to control, consciously control my breathing. What is happening in my brain, in my nervous system, is the control of the respiration, that is breathing, is shifting from medulla to cortex. Basically, it comes into the frontal lobe. In the medulla, the respiratory center, when we sleep, who controls our breathing is the respiratory center. When I'm not paying attention to my breath, who controls the breathing? It's this respiratory center. But when I pay attention to the breath, when I am consciously becoming aware, when I am being mindful, my attention is to the breath, this control shifts from medulla to the primary motor cortex, primary cortex, and to the frontal lobe. And in this process, what is happening is there's deactivation of sympathetic nervous system and amygdala. And this amygdala and sympathetic nervous system, they play a very crucial role in all our negative emotions, such as stress, anxiety, anger, depression, sadness. If this is deactivated, there is no way that these emotions will be there. So conscious control of breath certainly reduces these negative emotions of stress, anxiety, anger, depression. And when these negative emotions are down, and when you're focused on your breath, it allows a better control of thoughts and emotions. Because your brain can do only one thing at a time. If you're paying attention to the breath, which is very important, the brain understands that breath is a very crucial process for life. So when you're paying attention to breath, the brain does not look at anything else. It is entirely focused on breathing. And that gives you a focused and concentrated state of the mind. And now this focused and concentrated state of our mind is a state of mind where you have control over everything that's happening in your mind. And this is actually the focus of pranayama practice. So improve the efficiency of your respiratory system. Start taking deep breaths. That will help you improve the health. And then when you are consciously focusing on this breathing, your mind is also controlled completely. So this is how the physiology of pranayam we can understand. There are different types of pranayam that are given in the ancient texts. I'm just going to give you a little classification of these different types of pranayam that are taught traditionally. The first classification, plus first type, you can say, is the dynamic type of pranayam. It is comparable to hyperventilation. although the processes involve bit more complex techniques, the first simple dynamic practice is fast breathing. Normally we inhale 15 times in a minute. In fast breathing we increase that speed more than 15. Maybe it goes to 30, 40, 50 breaths per minute, even 100 breaths per minute. So you're really inhaling and exhaling fast. Another powerful type of pranayam called Bhastrika pranayam, that involves the same fast breathing, but you inhale the increase the volume per breath to as much as you can. So very intense inhalation and exhalation with a speed of say 120 breaths per minute. Kapalbhati is actually a cleansing technique, but it's also a breathing technique. So you can consider that as a dynamic and hyperventilation type of breathing practice, where you forcefully exhale. The inhalation is passive and exhalation is forceful. And again, the rate, the speed of exhalation is maybe 50, 60 per minute or even 120 per minute. This type of pranayam is certainly going to increase the oxygen levels. It's certainly going to reduce the carbon dioxide in your blood. Oxygenation is good. Removing carbon dioxide is also good. But sometimes these practices can make us feel dizzy. And it can also increase the blood pressure. So you need to be very careful with these practices. If someone has had any surgeries in the abdomen or chest region or brain surgeries, then these practices should not be done without taking help of the medical professionals and senior yoga practitioners. Then the next type of pranayam is balancing pranayam, Nadi Shodhan pranayam or alternate nostril breathing. Now this is a very relaxing type of pranayam. Generally everyone can do this pranayam. There is no precaution restriction as such, except don't stretch your proportions too high. So don't try and inhale in 10 seconds and exhale in 20 seconds. When 4 seconds inhalation and 8 seconds exhalation is little hard for you. If 5 is to 10 is easy, you can stick to that. So you inhale through left, say in 5 counts, and then you exhale through say right nostril with 10 counts. When I say count, you can equate every count with 1 second. Say 4 seconds inhalation, 8 seconds exhalation, 5 seconds inhalation, 10 seconds exhalation. Left nostril and right nostril. Now, the left inhalation in yoga is considered inhalation through Ida Nadi or the moon principle, and is more connected with our mind. The right nostril inhalation is from Pingala Nadi or sun principle, or connected with more physiological activities. So, right nostril is more connected with physical activity, so we can say that right nostril is like a body and left nostril is more connected with mental dimensions, mental activity, so it's more like mind. So when you do this balancing pranayam Nadi Shuddhi, you're trying to balance your mind and body and mind. It's a very important practice in yoga. In fact, if you're practicing pranayam, you have to practice Nadi Shodhan pranayam. And it's made as the compulsory practice in pranayam. Then there are other practices which are generally considered very relaxing practices, opposite of dynamic. Deep breathing, for example, inhaling through both nostrils, say for 4 seconds or 5 seconds or 6 seconds, and exhaling through both nostrils, again for say 8 seconds, maybe 10 seconds or 12 seconds. But there are two more types of pranayam. Again, very effective in relaxation. One is called Bhramari. In this Bhramari pranayam, Bhramara is humming bee. So you make a sound like a humming bee with your exhalation. And this humming sound relaxes the entire nervous system. With this sound, you can easily focus on the exhalation. You can easily concentrate. and you're concentrating on breath and sound. So there's one more center in your brain, auditory center, is also active. So Brahmari Pranayam is actually more effective than just deep breathing. In deep breathing, your focus is only on the frontal lobe. So of course, your brain can only focus on one thing. So you're focusing on the breath. So that's really good. But here in Brahmari, because the sound is there, one more center in your brain is active. The Ujjayi Pranayam, on the other hand, is a contraction in the throat and is a sound of breath. It's not the sound of vocal cords like Brahmari. In Ujjayi, you just compress the throat and you create a hissing sound of the breath, not from the vocal cords. Now, when you compress and contract the throat, there are some studies that say that Ujjayi Pranayam improves the oxygen absorption in the lungs. And some other studies also say that Ujjayi Pranayam is stimulating parasympathetic nervous system, that is relaxation. And it's known that if you practice Brahmari and Ujjayi, it brings down the blood pressure, it brings down the stress level. Of course, if you do deep breathing, the same things you can observe. But in Brahmari and Ujjayi, you see it more enhanced effect, more increased effect of relaxation. Then another category of pranayams is heating pranayam, the ones that increase the heat in our body. If you inhale through right nostril, is the sun principle, which is hot. So it's going to increase the heat in your body. Fast breathing, Kapalbhati or Bhasrika pranayam, all dynamic pranayams are also heating. When you inhale and exhale so many times, the exchange of gases and other intracellular fluids, the rate of that increases and there's rush. So it's a stimulation to your sympathetic nervous system. So you can see that with blood pressure increasing with these heating practices or dynamic practices. These practices are also good if done within limits. Say you're doing 200 strokes, so 2 minutes you do it. Very good. 3 minutes you're doing it. Very nice. But if you do it for more than 5, 6, 7 minutes, then there is a chance that you may have higher blood pressure, or you may have more acidity, or you may have migraine, because the heat in your body is going to increase. There are three other types of pranayams which you can classify as cooling pranayams, which reduce the heat in your body, which reduce the stimulation that's given. The first is left nostril breathing. So you inhale through left nostril. Like in heating pranayam, you inhale through right nostril and exhale through any nostril. That is heating. And cooling pranayam, you inhale through left and exhale through any or both. So that is triggering more of your mental energy. The Ida Nadi is with more with moon, and it shows more relaxed and calm state of your body. And left nostril is also considered cooling, like moon. Sun is heating, moon is cooling. There are some studies that confirm what these ancient texts have said. So you can safely take this right nostril as slightly more stimulating, more active type of pranayam, cooling pranayam. Left nostril is more of relaxing and passive type of state of our body, but active state of mind. Then there are two more pranayams, Shitali and Sitkari, where you inhale through your mouth. These are the only two pranayams in the entire pranayam practices that you inhale through mouth. Shitali is you roll your tongue and inhale through the tongue. Sitkari is you open the lips but bring the upper and lower teeth together and inhale through the gaps between your teeth. So in both types of pranayam, the air is passing via your tongue and the tongue is little moist. So because of the air passing via this water, the moisture, it's cooled. And that cool air entering into your abdomen, because you are mostly inhaling through mouth, of course it enters the lungs as well, but it enters into your abdomen to some extent. So these, actually the cool air in your abdomen brings down the core temperature a little bit. That's what the ancient books have said. And it's very effective against the effect of heat. Say it's very hot outside and you do these two pranayams or even the left nostril breathing, you will immediately start feeling comfortable and cool. But if it is hot and you do this right nostril breathing or fast breathing or Kapalbhati, it's going to make you feel even more hot. You can see these effects for yourself as well. The ancient books have recommended a balanced practice of all these different types of pranayam. So you should practice 1 to 2 minutes, 3 minutes of fast breathing or Kapalbhati or Bhastrika pranayam. Then you should do maybe 3 to 4, 5 minutes of alternate nostril breathing. Then you should do some relaxing pranayams. Now heating and cooling are depending on your requirement. But the first three types are recommended every day. So this is how the pranayam practice works. I hope you have understood some scientific perspectives of this pranayam practice as well as the practice aspect. Hari Om.